out of your belly, shallow. Rivers of living water.
Welcome to the Men of Integrity, men that rescue men and women. As always, we are delighted that you have joined us tonight for a journey through the Word of God. I want to suggest to you tonight that you should call a neighbor and a friend and let them know that the Men of Integrity is on the air, because there is a word concerning you. God is ready for you to experience this life-changing experience. He's ready for you to be blessed abundantly, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Yes, my friend, even in crisis like this, you can be blessed. So call a neighbor, call a friend, and tell them there's a word concerning you. Apostle J. Edward Fisher, our co-host, pastor of Saints Center, Coppers Cove, and Colleen is in the house tonight.
All right. Well, great, Bishop. I'm just thanking the Lord for just another day, another day's journey, and I'm so glad.
Amen.
Remember that song?
Yes, I do. Every day on this side of the dirt is better. So we are excited, amen, tonight. Amen, that you are here with us tonight. Let's get into the Word of God, which is found in Isaiah 55, verses 6 and 7. And here's what the writer says. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. And let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Apostle, when you look at this particular text, it suggests a lot of things. One of the first things that he suggests is that there is a time where God will not be found. When you look at the revelation of the text, it says, seek ye the Lord, and then the word, while, meaning that at some point in time, people are going to call upon him, and he's not going to be near, if you examine this text. And so what are we saying to the people today, 2020, going into 2021, that has not yet received the fulfillment of promise?
Definitely this is the time to seek the Lord. With all of the things that are happening and everything like that, it's time to turn and consider a lot of things. I mean, you got to consider how that this pandemic changed the whole world. You know, one month we were in Christmas having a good time. Next month, the whole world looked like it was shut down. So we got to look to God again, start thinking about that. You know how when we're having a good time, we're going on, we kind of like push God to the side. No, we need to bring him back into our thoughts and say, what does all of this mean? Because time is going on. You understand what I'm saying? And time, and there's an end that's coming. And we can't wait till the end. We got to do something now.
Amen. When I look at this text, and he says, seek ye the Lord while he may be found, call upon him while he's near, there was a reason why the writer suggests that you make this call, that you be cognitive to the time and the season when the Lord is present. And when he is present, he is prepared to do what the writer says. Let's qualify the reason why this writer says, seek the Lord and call upon him. When you look at Matthew chapter 10 and verse 8, it says that he healed the sick, he raised the dead, he cleansed those who have leprosy, he drives out demons, and he says, freely you have received, so freely give. So when you stop and you look at this, why are you still in the same condition? Why are you dealing with the same hurts, disappointments? Why are you still in poverty and lack? when the writer suggests that if you seek the Lord while he may be found mm-hmm. and call upon him while he's near, it is possible that you could have a life-changing experience.
That's right.
Now, there's some other things that go along with that, which will unfold here, but I need you to focus on the fact that he is qualified to meet the very need of the individual that seeks him and call upon him while he is in the area.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, the Bible also says, it says, when you hear the voice of the Lord, harden not your hearts. You understand what I'm saying? And then there's a time we're looking at that God is saving to the utmost, but it's going to end. Mm-hmm. It's going to end. And so we've got to take advantage of that, because one day it's going to be too late. And that's just a dreadful thing to look at.
Absolutely. I want to challenge your thoughts tonight. I want to challenge your behavior. Mm. Psalms 37:5 says, commit thy ways to the Lord. Mm-hmm. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. What is it tonight that you need God to bring to pass in your life? Mm. When you look at Isaiah 55:7, he gives you some practical applications. He says, let the wicked forsake his way. You cannot continue in your own ways if you want change.
That's right.
Change requires you to take an action that brings about the desired change. What is it that you want to be different in your life? What is it that you want to be new in your life? God is here. He's voice calling away. He's seeking a way. He's not hard to find. He's not hiding himself. And so again, the question arises, why are you still in this poverty state? Mm. Why are you still in this hurt and disappointed frame of mind? Why are you still frustrated, aggravated, and irritated? Why are you not even saved and enjoying the goodness of the Lord? Where is your joy, your peace, and your righteousness in the Holy Ghost? When God says, if you seek me, you'll find me. Mm-hmm. If you knock, the door shall be open.
That's right.
If you ask, it shall be given unto you. Let me throw this piece in and you jump in, Apostle. He says to us in Mark, he says, whatsoever you ask, when you pray, mm-hmm. believe, and you shall receive it. It's hard to understand why people are settling for what they're settling for when God has promised them so much more.
Yeah. Well, you know, when you think about it, Proverbs says, it tells us to trust in the Lord. But if you don't trust in the Lord, you're just not going to acknowledge him. Mm-hmm. And that's the problem there. But here's what he promised. He said, if you acknowledge me in all your ways. Now, you see, all your ways. Mm-hmm. That's a real big word there.
Yes.
But, you know, sometimes we think that we know this and we know that. No, he said, in all your ways, and I will direct your path. Eventually, if you lean to your own understanding, you're going to find yourself having to come back and say to the Lord, well, I didn't do it, and now I really need your help. And mm-hmm. so I think it's a big trust factor there. And with trust, there's two components. You can start off in faith, mm-hmm. but you're going to have some patience to wait on the Lord.
Absolutely. When you stop and you think about the devastation mm-hmm. and crisis that we are experiencing today, mm-hmm. God is a present help in the time of trouble. Mm-hmm. He's a present help in your personal trouble. But what has to happen, here's another practical application. Your mentality has to change.
That's right.
He says, and the unrighteous man, here in verse 7 mm-hmm. of the 55th chapter of Isaiah, the unrighteous man, his thoughts, mm-hmm. he has to forsake his thoughts.
That's right.
You know, you hear a lot of Christians and church people quote Jeremiah 29:11, mm-hmm. but it's not applicable to a lot of people, because if it was, you would understand that you do not have the right nor the authority to think of yourself in any way other than what God has spoken concerning you. If you understand that, then you understand that I need to forsake my thoughts. Mm-hmm. And I need to let this mind be in me, which was also in Christ Jesus. That mind is to always focus on the fact that Matthew 10 and 8 says, he's a healer of the sick, he's a raiser of the dead, he's a cleanser of the leprosy, he drives out demonic forces, mm-hmm. and the opportunity to receive that is free. Mm-hmm. So we have no reason to be in this pity party. Mm-hmm. We have no reason to be discouraged and fearful when God has said, if you seek me, you'll find me. If you call me, I'll answer.
Yeah, you know, God has made it as easy as he could make it. He said, trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not. You don't even have to try to figure this out, Bishop. All you got to do is just bring it to him.
Yes.
In fact, he said, come unto me, all ye that labor and heavy laden, take my yoke upon you, learn of me, and you shall find rest for your soul. But that's not what we're doing, Bishop. We're trying to keep our hands in it, and we're trying to keep we got to think that our hands have to be in it. You remember what happened with Abraham and Sarah? After for a long time, then Sarah comes up with an idea, and that idea is plaguing us today.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, the mentality of man, it's difficult for them to forgive themselves. Mm. And as long as you don't forgive yourself for the lack thereof, or the error of your ways, or just the blatant sin against God, you get stuck in a mentality that you don't believe that God will have mercy. But the writer suggests here in Isaiah 55, 6 and 7, mm-hmm. if you seek the Lord and if you call upon him, mm-hmm. if you forsake your way and your thoughts, the next application he says to you is you need to come back to God.
That's right.
The Bible says, come boldly to the throne of grace and let your request be made known through prayer and supplication. With a humble and a spirit of humility, you have to return to God. But God doesn't have mercy until you return. And to return is repentance. It means to return to the highest place. Mm. That's God, mm-hmm. to the highest authority, to the only one who has the ability to wipe away, wash away, and remove your sins so that the blessings of God can flow in your life.
Yeah, well, I like what you said. Yes, we need to forgive ourselves, but then we need to make sure that God has forgiven us. You yes. understand what I'm saying? We may even forgive ourselves, but there's someone that we have to answer to. Now, yes. if we only had to answer to ourselves, we might be all right, but we know we don't.
Yes.
And then he said he not only will forgive us, but he'll cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now, that's what we need. We not only need forgiveness, yes. but we need what? Cleansing. You understand? And Old Testament, they had covering. But in the New Testament, since Jesus have come, we got cleansing now.
Hallelujah. And how can a young man cleanse his way?
That's right.
Except he heed to the word of God. I'm suggesting to you tonight that you no longer have to live in brokenness.
Come on now.
You no longer have to live in fear and frustration. You can live by faith. You can walk by faith. You can pray by faith, and God will answer your prayer. Jeremiah 33 and 3 is ringing in my ear, and it says, call upon me, and I will answer you, and I will show you things that you did not know. It's no reason to walk in ignorance. It's no reason to sit there and ponder and wonder, what is my next step? How do I need to do this? No, call upon the name of the Lord.
That's right.
He will answer you, and he'll tell you things that you do not know. Now, it says here in the latter part of verse 7, it says, God will abundantly pardon you. In order for us to have growth in our lives, and if we have growth in our lives, Apostle, things around us begin to grow. That signifies that there is life,
mm-hmm.
and there is life more abundantly. But that doesn't happen without the pardon, okay? God forgiving you and washing away and removing and cleansing us of all of our sins.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, here's the thing, that if he just pardoned us, Bishop, that would be okay. But he said he will abundantly.
Yeah.
That sounds, man, that sounds like, that sounds just a, well, I should say, if you didn't even know what the word meant, you know it's something more than just being pardoned. Right? And, right? And it must be good because God is good, right?
That's right.
And I would be, I would accept the pardon, but I'm looking for the abundance too.
Yes.
What else do I get with this here? You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
And so God certainly wants us to be blessed, and he gives us a simple way to do it. He says, seek the Lord. But that's what we don't do. I mean, come on, you know, if a billionaire told me, he said, listen, I know he was a billionaire. He said, any financial problem you have, you just give me a phone call. I'll take care of it. But God owns everything.
Everything.
And then Weinstein said, that billionaire could lie, and there's nothing I could do about it.
Mm-hmm.
But God cannot lie.
Cannot.
You understand what I'm saying? So that's what he's trying to show us, how sure this thing is if we do it, but we don't trust him.
And that's a part of the problem, us not being made whole.
Mm-hmm.
We have partial trust and partial faith because of the experiences of our past. We've been let down, we've been disappointed, you know, we've just been downright forsaken by family, by friends, by jobs, by everything. But God has never forsaken us.
Never.
God has never left us out there alone. As a matter of fact, the writer says, I will never leave you, I will never forsake you, and I will never fail you.
Mm-hmm.
But because we have become fragmented, because we are still wounded, because we still are reminiscing the past, and we look at other people's highlight rims, and we look at what we have accomplished, and we become discouraged. But tonight, I'm challenging you that if you would seek God's face, if you would turn from your wicked ways, if you would humble yourself, God is ready to answer you. And he's ready to do some things, glory to God, that are supernatural in your life. Here's my question to you tonight. How long are you willing to allow people, places, and things to stop you from getting what you want?
Mm.
You have a desire. You have something that you want deep down in your side. It could be your spouse, it could be your husband, it could be your children, it could be coworkers, it could be, amen, church folks, it could be a whole bunch of folks that are hindering you from getting what you want because they keep dashing water on your dreams, glory to God, and they keep discouraging you with, you can't do this and you don't have this and this is not possible. But when are you gonna see God for his direction and his guidance? And the writer says, Apostle, that when you receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, it will lead and guide you into all truth, meaning what is really capable of happening in your life. And all things are possible.
That's right. In fact, that's one of the truths he'll lead you into. He says, all things are possible to him that believe. I don't care what other people say. He says, with man, things are impossible, but with God, all, not some, all, your little situation, whatever it is. You know, I was praying this morning, and the Lord just dropped the scripture. I know the scripture. I read it many times.
Mm-hmm.
But it just reminded me of it in Isaiah 41 and 10. It says, fear thou not, for I'm with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God.
Yes.
I will help thee. I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. I mean, all God needs is to give us a word.
That's it.
And that just changes everything because the word is just what it is. It's the truth, and it just will free you. It will just free you. That's why God wants, watch this here, God wants you to seek him because you need to hear from him. You've heard from everybody else. Yeah. You heard from mama, you heard from daddy, you heard from family, you heard from co-workers, and watch this here, and they ain't really got too much to say good to you, but you need to hear from God. When you hear from God, it changes everything.
What do you want tonight?
Mm-hmm.
What do you want different in your life tonight? Whether it's your healing, whether it's your sanity, whether you want to be healed of your brokenness, whether you're in a financial strait, it doesn't matter. Whatever it is, we have a God that is able. He prophesied through the prophet Ezekiel. And he says, I'm the God of all flesh. Mm-hmm. And there is nothing too hard for me to do. But if you're not willing to take steps, if you don't have an expectation, if you don't have an expression, and if you don't execute the plan of God for your life,
all right,
then all you could hope for is fragments and brokenness. Here is the instructions of God in James chapter 1, apostle, in verse 22. He says, but be ye doers of the word, not doers of methods, okay? Not doers of old wife fables and all this other stuff that people are suggesting to you. He says, no, be doers of the word, not hearers only, because deceiving yourself. Nothing is going to happen because you watch this TV program tonight. Nothing is going to happen because you showed up at the church building. But something is going to happen when you listen to this program tonight and you show up at the church building and you hear the word and then you put into action that which you heard. Okay. That's a miracle that's going to take place in your life.
Right, right. And I think it goes on saying, you probably said it, if you don't do this thing that you hear, watch this here, you will self-deceive.
Yes.
You deceive yourself. The enemy don't even have to deceive you. Mm-hmm. You're deceiving yourself. And so when we hear the word, watch this here, it is the word of God. And it will work. You understand? And nothing will be able to stop it, and nothing will be able to stop God. But you got to do it.
Absolutely. You know, James 1 and 6 says, but he must ask in faith without doubting. Here's what I want you to wrap your mind around. God has been doing so many little things in your life since you was a child that validates that he is real and that he is capable of doing what's needed. Ephesians 3 and 20, which is my favorite scripture, It says, now unto him who is able to do exceedingly apostle abundantly above all that you could ask or think of him according to the power that worketh in you. When you stop and look back over your life, you can identify some things that God has done, and knowing that without God, this would not have been possible. Mm-hmm. You can look back in the lives of your siblings, your parents, you know, your friends, whatever, and you know beyond any reasonable doubt that it was God. Mm-hmm. And God said, I've done that so that you would have faith. I've done that so that you will know that I am God and I'm able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you can actually think of me. So now the practical application says you got to grow up, you got to mature, and you got to pull your thoughts together and know that this God is real and capable.
Yeah. And you know, I'm thinking, I'm glad you said that. You know, God authenticates the fact that it's him. That's why that word abundant comes in. See, mm-hmm. you could probably just get this and get that. But when it's God, God puts his signature on it to let you know that it's God. Yeah. You understand? I tell people, I say, if it's not abundant, it's not God.
If you need a dollar, man is going to give you that dollar. But if it's God, he's going to give you $100. Why? Because that's grace.
Yeah.
Okay? That's grace abounding
there
towards
you.
And he says, listen, I'm able to make all grace abound towards you, mm-hmm. having all sufficiency in all things at all times. So God doesn't just give you just that dollar. He says, mm-hmm. no, I'm going to give you more because I want you to know who I am and what I'm representing.
Yeah.
Here is a signature of God. and it has a lot to do with us. And I'm reading you this text because I really need you to grab something here. Mark chapter 1 and verse 32 to 34. And at the evening, when the sun did set, they brought unto him, key word, all that were diseased, mm-hmm. and them that were possessed with devils. Everybody in the city, the writer says, was gathered together at the door. But here is what you got to grab. And he healed many that were sick of divers diseases and cast out many devils. and suffer not the devil to speak, because they knew him. Notice here, they brought all to him, but he only healed many. Mm. Because that was some that had no expectation. That was some that had no faith. That was some that just came to just see what was going on. But those that had the faith, those that believed, those that sought him, those that asked him, are the ones that he healed, Apostle.
Mm-hmm. I'm thinking about blind Bartimaeus. Hmm. When he knew that Jesus was near. See, when you know that Jesus is near, when the Spirit of the Lord is moving, you need to call him then. And he started calling Jesus, and some people tried to shut him up, even some of the disciples.
Yeah.
But you can't let people shut you up when Jesus is near. And our text says, call upon him while he is near.
Yes.
Praise the name of the Lord.
It is so important tonight that mm-hmm. you understand what it is that you want. Mm. You got to know what you want tonight. You got to be specific with God in the things that you want tonight. For so long, you've been general. And you can't even put your hand on it to know if God did it or not, because you were not specific in the things that you wanted God to do. Some of you have received different. Some of you have received better. But you have not received change. Because if any man be in Christ, mm-hmm. now he's a new creature. The old things are passed away, and behold, Apostle, all things have become new. So tonight, you must obey the word of God. You must seek the Lord while he may be found. You must call upon him while he's near. Mm-hmm. You must forsake the wickedness of your way. Unrighteous man must forsake his thoughts. We must return to the Lord, and it is only then will God have mercy upon you and abundantly pardon you, and that's when you get what you want.
There you go. Well, praise the name of the Lord. What can we say? He still stands ready to say, come unto me, all ye that are laboring. You know you're laboring, you know you're frustrated, and you know you're aggravated, as Bishop said. Praise the name of the Lord. So all you need to do is come. But you got to do that.
Yes.
You understand? He said, draw nigh unto me.
Yes.
And I'll draw nigh unto you.
You know, tonight you need to re-examine Isaiah mm-hmm. 55,
yeah.
verses 6 and 7. And you got to ask yourself, why am I the same? Why am I dealing with this hurt, this brokenness? It's been tens of years. Mm. Why am I in this poverty situation? No, it's not because God's trying to teach you anything. It's because you will not grab the word of God and implement the word of God so that you could be blessed just like he promised. I'm telling you, you can join us in any of our services.
Yes.
And we guarantee you a life-changing experience. We are the men of integrity, and we are praying for your miracle.
Out of your belly, out of your,
Chevrolet.
Out of your.